Good evening, everyone, and thanks for tuning in tonight. This is Graceful Moments with Joe, an evening edition. Earlier today, I was talking with a dear friend of mine, Steve Johnson, and he was talking about these devotions I've been doing. And he said, Joe, you know, what would be really cool is if you would do one on prayer. And so he's the first one who's asked me to do a devotion on a specific topic. And so I wanted to share that with you tonight. And I see he's tuning in. Hey, Steve. And we were talking on my way home, and he said, I'd love for you to share something on prayer. So when I thought about it, there's a lot of things I can tell you about prayer, but I would rather go to the source of the greatest example of prayer we have in Scripture. And so I want to read to you tonight first from the book of Matthew, and then we'll talk about what Jesus demonstrated and told his disciples about prayer when they asked him about it. In Matthew chapter 6, beginning in verse 5, it says, "And when you pray, you must not be like the hypocrites, for they love to stand and pray in the synagogues and at the street corners, that they may be seen by others. Truly I say to you, they have received their reward. But when you pray, go into your room and shut the door and pray to your Father who is in secret. And your Father who sees in secret will reward you." And then he goes on at the end of verse 8 and says, "Your Father knows what you need before you even ask him." And then Jesus told his disciples, he said, pray like this: "Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we also have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil." And he says, "For if you forgive others their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive others their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive your trespasses." So as I think about the Lord's Prayer as it's written here in Matthew, and I look at the order that Jesus went through with his disciples, and I think about what was Christ demonstrating to us about our prayer lives and what our prayers should be like. And notice that Christ opened up and he says, "Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name." So at the very opening of his prayer, he was demonstrating reverence for his Father. And if Christ the Son shows reverence for his Father, how much more should we? So he opened up showing reverence for his Father. And then he talks about God's will being done, not his own. Notice nowhere in there did he say, "My will be done." He says, "Your kingdom come, your will be done." That's towards the very beginning of the prayer. So he's talking about, Lord, let your will be done. Let your will be done. May it take precedence over our own will, over our wants, our needs, our desires. We should pray that the Lord's will would be done. He says, on earth as it is in heaven. And then he asks for provision. Give us this day our daily bread. Now, sometimes we get those things out of order because so often we think the only point in praying is asking for provision, asking for things. I remember the Christian artist Babbie Mason years ago had a song called Never Ending Shopping List, and talking about all the things she would ask the Lord for. And too often, myself included, too often I'll start a prayer, "Oh Lord, can you please help me with this today? Will you please do this today? Will you please do that today?" And Christ demonstrated that the Lord, it's okay to ask for provision. It's so okay to ask for God to take care of your needs, because that's what he desires to do anyway, because he is a loving Father. But he shows us first how, in order, he prayed, first of all, showing reverence for his Father. Then he said, "Lord, your will be done." Before he went to ask for anything specifically, he talks about, "Lord, let your will be done." And as a part of the Lord's will, he asked for provision for daily bread. And then he asked for forgiveness. says, he's teaching his disciples to ask, and he says, forgive us our debts as we have forgiven our debtors. So here's a picture of asking for forgiveness. And he goes on to say, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. They lived in a world with evil, just as we do today. They lived in a world just as we do today, that we need protection from the evil around us. We need protection from the attacks of the enemy, and we also need guidance that our own flesh would not lead us into temptation. Then he talks about the importance of forgiving others. He says, if you forgive others their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. So Christ is demonstrating here through that part of the prayer that when we come before the Father, if we hold things against someone else, we need to forgive them. Last night, I was at my church at Anniston Road Baptist in Snellville as part of the Celebrate Recovery Ministry. And we heard a testimony from a lady who had been abused in many, many ways by a family member from the age of 4 years old. And she talked about how that abuse had so tarnished her view of others and how she would lose trust in people, and so many ways it had negatively impacted her life. And that's really an understatement for what she had been through, if you heard the whole testimony. But she talked about the fact that after she became a believer in Jesus Christ, she had to come to the realization. She said that one day she was praying and said she couldn't understand why God would forgive, could even forgive that person who had hurt her over so many years. And she said she was praying. She's like, Lord, he doesn't deserve to be forgiven. And God reminded her in that moment that none of us deserve to be forgiven. Christ had to die a horrible, horrible, painful death on a cross for you and for me, so that we could be forgiven of our sins, so that through him we could seek and find forgiveness and mercy and grace and redemption. And I don't know, somebody out there tonight, you might be struggling with forgiving someone. You might be saying, I was speaking with a man last night who talked about he didn't really feel connected to God. That a lot of times his prayers, he just felt like he was throwing darts or kind of, and didn't really know that they were going to stick. And he just didn't feel that connection with the Lord. And sometimes when we feel that way, we need to examine our lives, because as Christ talks about here, before we're going to seek forgiveness for ourselves and ask for forgiveness, we better forgive others. And maybe you're out there tonight and there's somebody who's hurt you so badly that you don't believe you could ever forgive them. I want you to think about what Jesus said from the cross. As he was being crucified, murdered, though he was sinless and did nothing wrong, he said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. And maybe somebody's hurt you and they didn't really know what they were doing. Maybe they did know. Even so, we're called to forgive them. This wasn't supposed to be a lesson on forgiveness, but it's just what God's showing me. There may be somebody out there and you're really struggling with forgiving someone, and you feel like your prayer life is going nowhere. So I encourage you to forgive that person, forgive that family, forgive that church, whatever it might be, whoever it might be. I encourage you to forgive them. Ask God to give you the strength to forgive that person who's hurt you. I've been hurt a lot of times in my life. I've been hurt by people I trusted and hurt by people I loved. But because God is a God of grace and mercy and forgiveness, through him I learned to forgive those people. And so tonight, Christ demonstrates. Christ taught his disciples how to pray. And I want to tell you too, as my friend Steve was telling me today, he said, you know, Joe, I just talk to the Lord like I'm talking to my best friend, which is exactly what we should all do, because if you know Christ as your Savior, he is your very best friend. He is the one who loves you, who gave his life for you. He is truly your best friend. So I encourage you all, you don't have to go to the Lord with these and thous and all kind of flowery language. He just wants to hear from you. He loves to hear the praises of his children. And we all have plenty to thank him for and to praise him for and to show reverence to him for. He loves to hear the petitions, the cries of his children. When you're hurting, he loves to hear from you. When you're happy and joyful and you feel like everything in your life is great, he wants to hear from you. He wants to hear your praises. He wants to hear your petitions. He wants to hear your hurt. So tonight, I don't know what some of you might be going through tonight, and I see several of you have been tuning in. And so those of you who will watch this later, I want you to know the Lord wants to hear from you tonight. He wants to hear from you today whenever you see this. He loves you. He has sent his son to die for you, and he has great plans for you. So again, this is a model prayer for you, but God just wants to hear from his children. I encourage you, lift up your praise to him tonight. Lift up your voices and thank him for what he's done in your life. Lift up your prayers to him. Lift up your hurts to him. If you need to be ask him for forgiveness, he wants to hear that right now. So whatever you're doing, I hope you have time in the next few minutes when this video concludes. I hope you have time just to cry out to him, to call out to him. Lift up your praises, lift up your prayers, your petitions, your hurts, whatever it might be. We have a loving Father who wants to hear from his children. So I appreciate you all tuning in. I hope this is an encouragement to someone out there. Just know that God loves you. He has great plans for you. And he wants to hear from you. Hope you all have a great night. We will see you back here soon.